Ladies and gentlemen, good day, and welcome to the Barbeque Nation Q2 FY22 post-result analyst conference call hosted by Ambit Capital. As a reminder, all participants' lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Ashish Kanodia from Ambit Capital. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Bilal. Hello, everyone. Welcome to 2Q FY22 earnings call of Barbeque Nation. Today from the management we have Mr. Kayum Dhanani, Managing Director, Mr. Rahul Agrawal, CEO and Whole-time Director, Mr. Amit Betala, Chief Financial Officer, and Mr. Kushal Bhudia, Head of Strategy, IR, and Business Development. I would now like to hand over the call to the management for opening remarks, post which we will open the floor for question and answer. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Hello, everyone. This is Kayum Dhanani. A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you all are keeping well and staying safe. I take the pleasure and welcome you to quarter two FY22 conference call of Barbeque Nation. As you all know, the economy continues to open up and stringent restrictions are being gradually lifted, providing a relief in a year to medium term for dine-in establishments. In spite of partial opening of our outlets, we have seen considerable recovery in our dine-in business. Quarter two restrictions on seating capacity and weekend curfews had, of course, some impact on the operating performance. However, our diversification strategy of initiating the delivery services continues to reap benefit. Our delivery business continues to be strong contributor to our overall growth. During the first half of this financial year, our delivery business has grown at an annualized rate of 2.8x versus last year. We are experiencing a strong month-on-month growth in our core dine-in business. I'm happy to share that in the month of September 2021, overall revenues were at 116% of pre-COVID September 2019 revenues. The network expansion plan is on track. We have added two new restaurants in quarter two and another two new restaurants in October 2021. We also have a strong under construction pipeline of almost 10 restaurants. Our strategy to build extension kitchens to aid in the delivery business has performed well. We have now opened eight extension kitchens, further strengthening our new vertical. In the incoming quarters, as the impact of COVID further subsides, we endeavor to remain focused on our dine-in and delivery business growth with continued focus on network expansion. With this, I would like to hand it over to Mr. Rahul, who will take you through the performance of the company during this quarter. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Kayum. Good evening, everyone. I hope you and your loved ones are safe and healthy. With COVID cases receding and increasing number of vaccination in the country, the mobility has been gradually improving. There's also been a gradual easing of COVID-related restrictions, which augurs well for the growth of our dine-in business, and this has led to a strong recovery during the quarter. Our operating revenues were rupees 2.2 billion in quarter two FY22 compared to rupees 761 million in quarter two FY21, thereby registering a growth of close to 190% over the previous year. The operating revenues in quarter two were 105% of the revenues in pre-COVID comparable period of quarter two FY20. The business has seen month-on-month increase during the quarter, and we have exited the month of September 2021 at 116% of comparable pre-COVID month of September 2019. Going into the segmental revenue, our dine-in business grew at 183% versus the previous quarter, previous year. In quarter two FY22, the dine-in revenues were 83% of the dine-in revenues in pre-COVID comparable period of quarter two FY20. Similarly, again, if you look at the month of September, the dine-in business has almost recovered fully, with revenues at around 98% of the comparable pre-COVID month of September 19. This is the dine-in business I'm talking about. In addition to the strong performance in our dine-in business, our delivery business has also grown at 219% versus the previous year. While the sequential quarter-on-quarter growth in dine-in business was strong, our delivery business marginally got impacted as against the previous quarter due to industry-wide reopening of the dining segment. Now, however, the delivery business continues to be significantly higher than the peak achieved in quarter four of last financial year, which is just before the second wave. Also, during the quarter, 76 restaurants, which is around 35% of our restaurant network, had both dine-in and delivery operations for the full quarter. In these restaurants, we have achieved average quarterly sales of rupees 1.66 crores per restaurant and delivered a strong restaurant operating margins of 21.1%. The remaining 55% restaurant network were partially operational for dining during the quarter, thereby impacting their average quarterly sales and margins. These restaurants have also achieved average quarterly sales of close to 1.05 crores per restaurant and delivered restaurant operating margin of close to 13%. The blended restaurant operating margin in quarter two was 17.5%. This restaurant operating margin that I'm mentioning is without the impact of Ind AS 116. By that I mean that the rental is booked as part of expenditure. Without adding the impact of Ind AS 116, the restaurant operating margin would be close to around 26-27%. As of today, we have 98% of the restaurants where both dine and delivery are operational, and this is expected to drive strong recovery going forward. Our reported EBITDA was close to 500 million in quarter 2 FY22 versus 75 million in quarter 2 FY21. The reported EBITDA margins were 22.6% in quarter 2 FY22 versus 9.8% in quarter 2 FY21. We continue to remain focused on investment in our digital platform covering reservations, delivery, loyalty, and the impact of this we are seeing. The share of business coming from our own digital platforms have increased from 21.2% in quarter 1 this year to around 27.3% as on quarter 2 FY22. On our expansion strategy, we have opened 6 new restaurants, as Kim also mentioned, till date, and have another 10 restaurants under construction. And we have also launched 8 extension kitchens across 5 cities. With this, we'll open the floor for interactive Q&A session. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and 1 on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may please press star and 2. Participants are requested to use handset while asking a question. To ask a question, you may please press star and 1. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. We have a first question from the line of Susmit Patodia from Motilal Oswal. Please go ahead.
Hi. Good evening, Rahul and team. Hope everyone is safe.
Hi.
My first question is on the slide that you have given, quite interesting, and thank you for the slide on full ops, partial ops. Just to understand, you said that now in September, all the restaurants are fully operational. Is that understanding correct?
Not September. At the end of September, a few restaurants in Kerala and a few in Maharashtra were not operational, especially malls. When I say 98% of restaurants are currently operational, this is as of, say, 25th of October.
Okay, got it. So, okay, I get that one. And second aspect, Rahul, is if you can give us some more color and texture around the extension kitchens, what is the difference in CAPEX and with cities and, how are they progressing?
So we have opened 8 till now. Out of this, metro markets would have 6 and 2 of them are in tier 1 markets. We are spending approximately 25 lakh rupees per extension kitchen. and currently we're doing average sale of average monthly sale of approximately 9 to 10 lakh rupees. This is obviously the first 2 months that we've been operating it. We started this in the month of July end or so. So that's a broad number, and at these numbers we are broadly break even. So I think the way the extension and strategy will work is we need to increase our distribution presence to so that the delivery product is available to the consumer at a close proximity, and as these revenues go up, you know, we'll also see good margins. I think we are happy with the initial response that we got on these outlets.
So these are all dark kitchens, right? I mean, nobody knows that there is barbecue, correct?
Yes, we can say that, yes. But all of these actually are linked to one core barbecue nation outlet. So that's why we call it extension kitchen rather than dark kitchen, because the way the operating structure is defined in the system, be it from the employee side or be it from the production side, that they are dependent on one existing operating barbecue nation restaurants.
Okay, got it. They are not on the same premise, but they operate as extensions.
Yes.
Okay, got it. And my third question is, you have put an interesting line which says diversified menu options to provide multiple cuisines. So if you can just elaborate on that, are you venturing into any other cuisines now?
No, so I think the Barbecue Nation before, just 1 year before COVID, was only North Indian cuisine. Today we are serving obviously Toscano, which is Italian cuisine, and Indian cuisine, and also operating in two segments, which is dine and delivery. Earlier we are not doing that. As of now, there are a lot of R&D that keeps happening on various stuff, but I don't think we are planning to launch any particular diversified menu or a different cuisine, at least in short term.
Got it. Just lastly, you have also mentioned that 98% dine-in revenue in September 21. This is just for the month of September, right?
Yes.
Okay, got it. Thank you so much and all the best. Thank you.
Thank you, Shmit.
Thank you very much. A reminder for the participant to ask a question, you may please press star and one. The next question is from the line of Ashwin Agarwal from Akash Ganga Investment. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah. Yes, Ashwin. Go ahead.
First of all, congratulations for the great set of numbers. So first question of mine is, what will be the table turnover ratio on a dining side? Can you just give us a ball, like a nearby number or a range number?
So currently it would be between 1.6 to 1.8. We don't report that number, but ballpark number would be like that.
Okay. And my second question is, as the raw material prices are increasing on a high scale, so, and you don't have like on a inventory base, like you are not holding the inventory side. So do you think that will impact the margins on a gross basis, or you can say how would you hedge this thing on a cost side?
So this obviously is a challenging environment in terms of input cost, and that's a challenge. We are also experiencing some increase in our input cost, we believe that the way the season is coming, and the way as your dining business keeps going up, there may be some short-term impact on our gross margins, but we have not seen that in quarter two because we also have some flexibility to play around with some menu option during our entire buffet layout, so that we try and achieve around 65 to 66% gross margin like we've done in quarter two. I won't deny that there is definitely good amount of inflationary pressure on input cost side.
So still, are you planning to have a inventory on a safer side, or you are just working on a supply side only? So
no, so it is obviously tactical. We deal with a lot of SKUs, and in some cases we build our inventory. In some cases it does not make sense to build an inventory at such elevated prices. So it's a mixed tactical approach that we take.
Okay. And one more question I want to ask you about the CAPEX guidelines. So as per your CAPEX guidelines, on the cash burn side, you are burning a cash burn of 35 crores as you have said on your last con call. So can you just give me the ballpark figure of what you have spent right now and what will be you spending in next 6 months?
So the cash burn was in quarter one when we were deeply impacted by the second wave. In the current quarter, our adjusted EBITDA is approximately 25 crores.
25 crores, right?
Yeah, which is post without the impact of Ind AS 116. Before that, it's around 50 crores. So there's absolutely no cash burn. In terms of capex, we are looking at adding 20 outlets this year, which would mean capex of approximately 55 crores. And then there is another maybe 10 crores on some maintenance capex plus capex on some digital spend plus some corporate capex. Backend capex, so 65 crores in the current year, and going forward as we scale up our store network expansion, the capex will increase. Our average capex per outlet is approximately 2.7 crores.
Okay. And my last question would be, can you just give us a split between the tier one and tier two cities? Can you just break up the sales if you can possible, if it's possible for us?
You should reach out to us and we can give you some broad ballpark, but mostly tier one and metro markets would be around 75% and the balance 25% will come from tier two, tier three cities.
Okay, thank you. All the best. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Anyone who wishes to ask any question, may please press star and one. The next question is from the line of Nihal Jham from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Yes, good evening to the management and congratulations on the strong performance. A couple of questions from my side. Rahul, if I see, obviously, despite the opening of dine-in and that, say, coming back to 85%, we still sustain run rate of delivery at around 50 crores plus. So the first question is, in the past, we've guided that maybe longer-term delivery could be 20% of top line. Now, after what you've seen over the last two quarters, do you believe that there is a potential to take this higher?
No, I've always restrained from giving a percentage number of overall business. We see opportunity in both dining and delivery. And I think delivery, based on last two-year performance, also on a low base, has been doing extremely well for us. Yes, we are currently tracking to almost 50 crore plus every quarter. The way our extension kitchen is expanding and the way our delivery is also happening from the existing Barbeque Nation restaurants, I think our plan would be to take it up higher. But I can't give you a guidance on say number of extension kitchens today. I can give you that for Barbeque Nation total number of restaurants. But I think this will evolve, as we take out. We have expanded with 8 extension kitchens across multiple cities, and understanding the operational challenges, how to take it up, multiple stuff. So I think we are happy with the performance of delivery, and based on how the business is making sense and how the unit economics are evolving, we will change the pace of growth accordingly. I will not be able to give you a firm guidance on some delivery growth numbers as of now.
So is that the reason why I say in your CAPEX outlook also you are not counting the delivery kitchens in your guidance when you're giving the 65 crore number? Because even that's still 25 lakhs, and if you have a plan of, say, adding the next number, that would also add up to that. So is that the reason that you're still forming up a plan? That's why you don't want to give a CAPEX number, including the delivery kitchens? Like,
you can say that, but at 20 outlets of extension kitchens, 5 crore CAPEX, it won't move the needle much. The 65 that I've told, that I mentioned just before that, has some buffers also in terms of what you spend, right?
Just one last question. Of this delivery, would majority be BBQ in a box? Is it possible to share the proportion break?
Almost 2/3 is BBQ in a box.
Help. Sure. My second question was that while we are giving a guidance in terms of store expansion, say for the core Barbeque Nation, in terms of Tosano, is there a thought of scaling that concept up also? Because it's mainly based out of Bangalore at this point in time, right? So thoughts of taking it to other cities, or it will still be in a wait and watch mode for the coming time?
So when we give our store expansion guidance, this is consolidated that we talk about. So this year, we have almost finalized two. One is already in the construction, and one more is almost finalized. And we might have one more that we can look at. So this year itself, we can add three more Toscanos. We have 10 right now. We are already present in three cities now: Bangalore, Pune, and Chennai. And depending on how the internal bandwidth is, we might think of adding one more city of Toscano.
And if I may ask, ballpark, what is the revenue per store and capex per store that Toscano does?
So capex is approximately 2.2 crores. The revenue per store would be approximately 5 crores per year.
Perfect. That's helpful, Rahul. I'll come back in the Q&A with you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next question is from the line of Susmit Patodia from Motilal Oswal AMC. Please go ahead. Susmit, please go ahead with your question.
Yeah, sorry. Rahul, there's a loan given to subsidiary of 44 crores. What is that?
So this is a loan given to the international business of Barbeque Nation.
Okay. And I mean, why? I thought that is in a scale down mode.
So when we in the international business, we have some debt from one of the entities. The money that we raised from our IPO to repay the external debt, that money has been invested in international business in the form of debt and not in the form of equity. So that business is owned by us. So I don't think that makes a big difference.
So the loan given to the subsidiary is the money that the subsidiary will use to pay down its debt, is it?
They have already used to pay out the debt. There is no external debt now in the international subsidiary. So we are not paid invested in the international market to expand.
Okay.
That's not that was not the
yeah.
plan. But
okay.
I'm very happy to say that the international business has been in fact doing better than the India business today in terms of margin profile.
Okay. So this is not rethink of the international plan.
No. So the rethink of international brand is we have always maintained that first the business has to stabilize and then we will expand. I think the business is now stabilized. We have seen a consistent quarter-on-quarter performance over the last 4 to 5 quarters. And now we are in a position that whatever profits are generating in that market, we can reinvest the same profit in that market itself. We are not keen to further deploy capital from India to international market. We are seeing a lot of opportunities in India itself today.
Okay, got it. And the second question, Rahul, is payment of lease of 31 crores in the cash flow. Is that the full rental or is there still some concession that the company is getting?
So we have got some concessions even this quarter. That is in our other income in the reported financials. So whatever we have got and balance has been paid.
Okay, so could you tell us?
So
in the cash flow statement, Rahul, there is a, because of Ind AS, it gets very confusing, right? So we'll have to refer to the cash flow statement to understand the lease rental.
Right.
So that number is 31.2 crores or 312 million. So just wanted to understand how much is concession that you've used in the first half?
So overall concession, the first half would be around 10 to 12 odd crores for the entire 6 months.
Okay. For the entire 6 months. Okay. And the other question was, are you seeing any consumer behavior difference pre-COVID, post-COVID in dine-in? Are people eating lesser, healthier? Just wanted to understand that.
Not remarkably different. Our consumers come to us, to enjoy the elaborate menu that we have, both on the starter, main course, and desserts. And on that front, we have not seen any significant change.
And my last question is, in your Q1 commentary, you had said that one of the reasons for lower gross margin was that in delivery, there is lower gross margin, and it's also a ramp-up phase for you. How are the gross margins now in delivery? Are they coming closer to dine-in?
No, so it is still higher than dine-in, but it has improved as against the previous quarter. But one of the other comments that I also made last quarter was that one is delivery, the other one is also the fact that a dine-in where it is operating is not fully optimized, right? So your efficiency of buffet and all doesn't come back. This quarter, as the dine business came back and the efficiency of buffet has improved significantly, the gross margin also has improved significantly.
Got it. Okay. Perfect. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next question is from the line of Gaurav Jogani from Axis Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. My question is first regards to how, you know, the recovery has been planning for you ahead, you know, because I understand a lot of contribution for you, approximately, you know, 45-50% odd was coming through this offices kind of a network. And, you know, with them not fully functional as of now, and still you are able to do 100% of your sales pre-COVID. So with that opening up, how do you look, the overall sales ramping up ahead?
So yes, the corporates are still not back. So we are still seeing some mid corporates coming, but large corporates are still not back. But we also getting fillers of some of the IT companies now starting to come back to to restaurants, and with that coming fully, I think there's potential further upside coming on the covers and the number of transactions that we do in our restaurants. So yes, that's still something which is still not come back to normal.
Okay. Yeah. So I mean, my question was again, with that coming up, how do you see the overall sales trending then? Because that was a good part of the contribution, and now delivery is an incremental contributor. How do you see sales per store then changing on an overall basis then?
Yeah, so that's like I said, that's an additional upside that that hopefully should come soon. But it's very difficult for me to quantify a number that this much percentage of demand will come from corporate. Like I said, some part of mid corporates are anyway coming back to the offices, and some business of that is anyway coming to our restaurants now. The only one that is not coming is largely the IT crowd and the back office crowd in these places. So if I have to guess a number, this would be around maybe 15-odd percentage that should follow the upside. These crowds also used to give us large good bookings, which are still definitely missing in our business today.
Sure, got you. And in terms of my other question, while there is a rampant inflation that we have seen across, commodities and other things, have we initiated any price hike as of now in the first half?
So, yes. So, blended basis, we have taken around 3% price hike in this financial year versus last year. But as you know, our pricing decision is very, very localized. We have different prices in the same city. We have in different restaurants, and we have different prices for different parts of the day and different prices for different parts of the week. So on a blended basis, you will see that the average per check is up by around 3-odd percentage this year.
Sure. And my third question is, with regards to the, with the overall dining now, opening up with the pandemic now receding and everyone trying to gain in more of the consumer's wallet share. So have you seen the competitive activity increasing in any way?
So not much. In fact, as you know, in a lot of restaurants, the standalone restaurants that we typically compete with, we are a casual dining player. an average consumer spends almost 89 to 90 minutes in our restaurants. In that segment, we typically compete with more of single stores in the trade area that we operate in. And unfortunately, during COVID, a lot of these single restaurant player or a couple of restaurant players have not been able to survive the pandemic, right? To that extent, I think the competitive intensity in this market has only come down. We have not seen that that the competition has just drastically gone up. In fact, like I also said earlier, we are in a position wherein for a short term, which can last for 4 to 6 quarters, we are seeing lesser industry supply, and in fact, there should also be more demand because of now the vaccination numbers where they are, and more people getting the comfort of going out to dine in. So to that extent, at least the industry structure for us should be in our favor, definitely for 4 to 6 quarters. And post that, a lot of maybe single store restaurants players will start coming back in the business. Restaurant is a very fragmented business, as you know, right? Just that scaling it up is the trick in the game.
Sure. And my last question is with regards to, you being now targeting to open around 20-odd stores. So these 20-odd stores would be for the entire year, right? That will be reducing the one that you have opened six so far in this year? Or is it like 26?
No, 20 is for the entire year.
Okay. So the other thing that related to this is, the rentals, because you said also alluded that many single restaurants have closed down during this pandemic. So is there, availability of good real estate now to you at better rates, otherwise, which, you would have not been able to open earlier. So how is the trend there? And have you been able to renegotiate your rentals for a better rate for the normal scenario as well?
We might have short-term waivers when we had shutdowns, but not structural change in our rental renegotiations. Our rental has always been among us in the industry. Before COVID, our rent-to-rental ratio was approximately 10%, which is among the best, right? So we did not need to do any significant change in our core existing rental structure. In the new ones, we are very, very prudent in the way we sign deals, and that's the reason why we have never shut down any barbecue and restaurant in the country today. And that continues to happen. But yes, given that the industry structure is slightly changing, and I would say it's favorable in our case, we are seeing reasonable rentals in some of the really high rental markets, which has good potential, but the rentals are very high, and that's why we always stayed away from that. So today, I think those markets are opening up for us.
Sure. Thank you so much for answering my question. That's all from me.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. A reminder for the participant to ask a question, you may please press star and one. The next question is from the line of Ashish Kanodia from Ambit Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Rahul, quick question on the delivery business. I think you talked about that, at 9 to 10 lakhs, the business is breaking even. But maybe if you look at, one or two of the earliest extension kitchen which you have opened, what is the kind of delivery margins they are doing? And on the same line, what is the aspirations in terms of EBITDA margin for the delivery business?
So we're starting it now, and in the first 3 months, looking to revenue numbers that we are in, we are happy with the performance. I think at a number, at a sale of around 15 lakh rupees, we'll start making between 15 to 16% store level EBITDA margins in that model. And, I think expression wise, we can target, say, 25 lakh rupees per month also. But this will gradually happen. I think delivery business is something new for us. We have only done it for maybe last 18 months now, and we are also learning, as we go ahead. So I'm just being very, very cautious and careful in giving you any guidance on delivery. But one thing is for sure that the operating environment and the growth in the delivery segment is is expected to be huge, and we are also building ourselves to make it a core part of our business, such that a decent amount of share of the business comes from delivery, without compromising on our dine-in focus. So you know, we're absolutely not saying that that dine-in is non-priority and we're moving towards delivery. No, I think we're trying to maintain right balance between both of them, so that structurally, you know, say 5 years down the line, both will become a very strong business.
Got it. And then second question on a similar line is, you know, when I look at, say, the, you know, other expenses as a percentage of sales for 3Q and 4Q and compare it with the current quarter, it has gone up. So is it also because of, you know, higher share of delivery coming, share of revenue from delivery during the current quarter versus 3Q and 4Q? Is that the correct way to think about other expenses? And if that is the case, then as, you know, dining continues to recover and delivery, you know, as the percentage of sales goes down, your other expenses should also taper off from the current level?
Yes. So as delivery goes up, there's two additional delivery line items, which is not there now, dining line item. One is packaging cost, and the other is aggregator commissions. So these two add up in your other operating expenditure. So if you compare our business this quarter versus say quarter four of last year, wherein we did pretty much similar revenues, down by almost only 6 crores. But since the nature of business, the delivery business is almost higher by 25 crores or so, these two line items have led to slightly higher other operating expenditure and slightly lower EBITDA.
Sure. And just last question is on the Toscano, that, you know, there was a closure of Toscano restaurant during the quarter. So, right. You know, what led to that? Is it, again, more of a rental-led closure, or is there any other reason for which the store was closed?
So, unfortunately, that mall was going into some changes, and that store for us was not bleeding money, but also not significantly adding money. And there were some negotiations going on, based on which we just decided to move out of that place.
Sure, this is very helpful.
But that
doesn't
impact our profitability on Toscano at all. That was almost a break-even sort of model.
Sure, got it all. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next question is from the line of Manish Poddar from Nippon India. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi Rahul and team. So, you know, congrats on the good results. So, primarily three questions. Now, first one is on this Smiles program. How much is now the contribution of sales through this program?
So, approximately 30-odd% of our transactions have got this Smiles, you know, redemption happening.
And this is versus the 10% which you were at the beginning of the year?
Yes.
Okay. And would you also help me with data point? Let's say, you know, at EBITDA level during this quarter, you know, how would numbers stack up for Toscano and the international business?
So both are, Toscano is broadly around 15% EBITDA margin, and international business is around 17% EBITDA margin.
Okay. And just one last one. So this dark kitchen or extended kitchen strategy which you're using it only for Barbeque Nation and not wanting to explore Barbeque Nation in India and not wanting to explore this in, let's say, Toscano or, let's say, Barbeque Nation in international format?
So not in international format, but we are looking at one for Toscano also.
So have you already, let's say, test launched it, or is it still in discussion stage?
Still under discussion stage. But I think by end of the year, we should definitely have one or two of them.
Okay. And just one last one, sorry. So let's say gross margin level, when you're running a cloud kitchen, are the gross margins better than, you know, the restaurant margin, given probably wastages would be relatively lower?
No, gross margin is slightly higher for us for delivery versus dine-in. In dine-in, we have a large spread, and that gets distributed. In delivery, we have to send a fixed quantity of food, which has a particular cost. Whereas in dining, different person who come consume different amount of food. So on average, it helps us to reduce our food cost there. Further than more than apart from gross margin, there are two other variable costs that that come up in delivery, which is your packaging cost and your aggregated commission, which is not there in your dining business.
So
the contribution margin for delivery is lower than dining.
So where I'm not able to understand is, let's say if I compare it to you know couple of cloud kitchen companies which are large in size, you know, they largely at 10 lakh you know rupees, let's say 30,000 of sales per day, they generally you know are having decent margins, and let's say you know more similar to what your company averages, taking into account both the channel commission and you know other overheads which are there in the line items. Why are you saying that you need to move up your sales on a monthly basis from, let's say, 10 lakh to 15 lakh, then only you make substantial money up here?
So, it's difficult to compare with other players, but my guess is that some of the other companies that you might be listening to would have lower food cost versus our food cost. Our product is different, and maybe some packaging cost. Our product largely is barbecue in a box, which has got good packaging cost, and also our product has got significantly high you know value for money equation for our customers, which means that our food cost is also currently higher. I think both of these areas have also potential to further improve, which we are also working on. But as of today, the priority is not to jump on making money. The priority is to ensure that you set a right benchmark for you in terms of the product offering for the customer, and then you know scaling it is something that that you can that we've done in the past, and I think we can do comfortably.
It's not because of scale. That is what I'm hearing from you.
No, it's not because of scale. It is because of a higher food cost and the higher value product that we provide to our guests.
Got it. Thanks and all the best.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. The next question is from the line of Sameer Gupta from IIFL. Please go ahead.
So just one clarification on the CAPEX. You have done 30 crores of CAPEX till now and put up only 6 stores. So for 20 stores in total, 65 crores, how will that be enough?
Amit, can you take that? I don't think that makes sense. I think we must be thinking something. Amit, are you there?
Yeah. Yes. So that won't be a 30 crores of CAPEX. So if you're looking at 30 crores in the cash flow item, then that would be a clearance of the past dues as well.
Okay. Understood. So 65 crores will cover 20 stores and how many extension kitchens for the full year?
As I said, we have not considered that. Our extension kitchen is approximately 25 lakh rupees. 20 stores will do maybe around 55 crores of capex, and maybe another 10 crores for some maintenance capex plus some expenditure on the back end and digital assets, and maybe 2-3 crores for extension kitchen. So the 65 crore is not considering right now extension kitchen.
Right. Secondly, this 100 crore preferential you did to keep some buffer because of COVID second wave. Now, COVID second wave has been short-lived and you really haven't had to use that buffer much. So, could you just give some idea with this 100 crore or 90 crore or whatever is there with you extra, what do you plan to do with it? Would you be accelerating your store openings or is there any other way that you would like to use that money?
No, right now that is lying in our balance sheet. We have approximately 150 crores of cash, including what we raised in the IPO for CAPEX, and debt would be approximately 40 odd crores. So yes, 110 crores is net cash in the books today. And the pace at which we are also generating operating profit, so last quarter, for example, we generated 25 crores, which is pretty much a cash profit for us, which is good enough to also maybe open 7-8 outlets, right? I think our acceleration of growth is not dependent on cash or on funds right now. I don't think funds is a constraint right now. Our expansion has largely been constrained by the kind of real estate or rental deals that we get. As of today, I think our pipeline is very strong, and that's why and we also aggressively looking for sites in the market. So if we find sensible real estate deals which we can do, we will not shy away from adding more than 20 outlets even this year.
Right. And just wanted to understand this September, you mentioned that you are at 98% of pre-COVID. But if I want to look at it on a per store basis for September, because 98% is after adding new restaurants. So on a per restaurant basis in September, what percentage of same period 2 years ago you would be at?
So even in September, there were around 10 restaurants which were not operating, largely in Kerala and some in Maharashtra, and three that are still not operational. I think on a per store basis, this number should definitely be more than 90%.
Okay. And this is only for dine-in, right? Delivery is on top
yes,
of this
yes.
98%. So
yes, including delivery, we are at 116%.
Perfect. Okay, that's all from me, sir. Thanks and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next question is from the light of Anurag Lodha from Ambit Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. I just had one question. So is it possible for you to share the exit run rate for delivery revenue? Because, we did 20 crores in July, and then in Q2, the total was at 51 odd crores, right? So does that mean that August and September together combined for about 31 crore? And how does it shape for the rest of the year? Thanks.
Yeah, so yes, those numbers are there. So that's 31 for the last 2 months. And slowly we are seeing some upward trends also now. So you have that number. Sorry, what are you asking for? I didn't sign.
So I was wondering what is the run rate, the exit run rate for at least the delivery revenue?
So, October is still going on, so very difficult to give you a target now. But I think on a quarterly basis, a 50 crore plus number, some months are low, some months are high, right? August and September also get impacted because of months like Shraad and Shravan. In few markets, people don't consume non-veg in those months. So I would not read much. I think structurally, I think 50 crore plus number should be should be reasonably achieved. As we'll see, but maybe that's the reason why you're looking at it that way.
Right. So 50 crore, you mean for the quarter, right?
Yeah, for the quarter. Yes.
Got it. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhimanyu from GrowthX Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening. I have one question over here that out of these 20, how many restaurants are in the metro cities and how many are in the tier 2 tier 3?
So we would have around 12 to 14 restaurants in metro and tier 1 and around 5 to 6 in tier 2 tier 3.
And Rahul, could you tell me how much of incremental revenues do you have a number of how much incremental revenues you get from metro city as compared to tier 2, tier 3?
When you say incremental, you mean?
Say you have a new restaurant opening in a metro city, how much would be the sales as compared to tier 2, tier 3? Is it more or is it less?
No, so metro tier 1 is typically more because in those markets, by and large, barbecue is already present. There is a set of clientele that you already have. In tier 2, tier 3, as of today, when we go in those markets, this is typically the first restaurant in that market. So, there's a maturity curve that you have to go through in those markets. So, it's lower than a metro and tier 1 market.
Is there any put a number to it?
So, a metro can start with maybe anywhere between 40 to 60 lakh rupees per month. And a tier 2, tier 3 can start anywhere between, 30 to 40 lakh rupees per month.
Okay. Thank you. Love it.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you very much. A reminder for the participant to ask a question, you may please press star and one. The next question is from the line of Bharat from Money Control. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. Just two questions from my side. Sir, you have mentioned that there were some restrictions, obviously, in quarter two. But just wanted to understand, have the restrictions been fully eased? I mean, because you said in dining there was the 50% capacity restraint that was there for the operation. So as we speak, as on date, has it been completely relaxed, or the 50% capacity thing is still applicable across the restaurants?
So, look, a lot of these rules are also given at state level and some also at district level. We operate in today approximately 80 cities, so the rules are different in different markets. But broadly, what I can tell you is that these restrictions have been easing over a period of last one quarter. Be in terms of timing restrictions, or be in terms of in some of the states also there is lack of clarity whether it's 50% is still applicable or not applicable. So it's very difficult to give you a response in terms of that doesn't completely has it been completely relaxed? No, but yes, it definitely has been easing over what we saw in the last quarter.
So fair to say, like just a ballpark number, 70-75% of the restaurants would be like operational with full capacity. Full capacity.
No. I am not able to give you a full number because it depends. The rules are really different at different places.
Okay. And sir, my second question is that this extended kitchen concept that you alluded to. So basically, there in this extended kitchens, we have only the delivery infrastructure, right? And the food is sourced from the main restaurant that we have. Is this the way the concept works? Like, can you please?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So this has only the delivery guys and
yeah. When you say food is sourced from these all food come in the semi cooked format, and okay. The finishing last mile finishing always happens in the extension kitchen itself, and that's how we build that infrastructure.
Okay. So last mile finishing. So in semi cooked food comes from the existing
barbecue creation restaurant. Yeah.
Okay. Got it, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone who wishes to ask any question may please press star and one. The next question is from the line of Ashish Kanodia from Ambit Capital. Please go ahead.
Rahul, just on the store expansion, I think 20 is what we are looking at for FY22. Any sense on what kind of a store you are looking for FY23?
Yeah, so I think we should be able to do around between 35 to 40 stores in 23. But I think maybe a long-term perspective, I think by March of 25, we would target to take our network to around 300 outlets.
And this will be your overall store count, right, including Tuscano International?
Yes. We only give consolidated numbers. So this includes all three. So the why we do that is because it all depends on the kind of rental deals that you get, right? So if you get right rental deals for Toscano, we'll do that. If we get the right return on our capital in international market, we'll do that. If we get right return on Indian market, then we'll do that. So this is all inclusive, consolidated at the company level.
Sure. And then, just on the extension kitchen now, Barbeque Nation has a lot of focus on the case service index, right? So with the launch of your extension kitchen, how has the ratings changed? If you can throw some light on that, that would be very helpful.
So that's a good thing because on our extension, our ratings on extension kitchen are generally better than the ratings that we are getting on our core Barbeque Nation business. The reason is this particular team is entirely focused only on delivery and are not have to do both dine and delivery. So that is coming out there. And in terms of our guest feedback, you know, we also get a decent amount of business on our own app. And the rigorous GSI system that we have for dine business is also followed in our delivery segment for these orders.
Okay. Got it. Now, that's all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashish. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next question is from the line of Sameer Gupta from IIFL. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Percy here again. So I see in your presentation that the average quarterly revenue per restaurant for the stores which were fully operational was 16.3 million. So if I multiply that by 4, the annual run rate is 6.5 crores. And while the store is fully operational, in Q2, life had not returned to normal. So there could be room to sort of cater to higher number of guests in that restaurant once the demand comes back. So should we take solace from this number that once things are perfectly normal and people start going out and mobility index goes back to pre-COVID level, we should have like a close to 7 crore sales per store kind of a number?
Yes, there are some more possible opportunities that we definitely have. Like we also discussed earlier, pre-COVID our average revenue was around 6 crores without any dining business. And we're already seeing close to 1 crore, in fact more than 1 crore of dine-in or delivery revenue being added on the existing network. And now, this quarter, for example, dine-in was already operational and we didn't see, delivery still sustaining larger the same level. So blended basis, yes, I think these numbers should definitely look more than this.
Right. And assuming this 6.5 to 7 crores kind of run rate for the full year next year, what kind of total margin should we look at after corporate costs and everything?
So I think we should look at around 15% EBITDA margin after corporate costs and everything.
And this is
after the India adjustment also.
Okay. And this is at console level or is it
console level?
Okay. So 15% is adjusted for Ind AS, right? So pre-Ind AS accounting standard.
Yeah. Like as per in GAAP, IGAAP.
Yeah, as per the old accounting standard. Understood.
Yes.
Understood. And other thing I just wanted to ask you is, in terms of delivery, while this year you are definitely tracking higher than your guidance of I think 155 crores, you will easily achieve and actually exceed that. How do we see a ramp up of this delivery over the next 2-3 years? So should we just, after whatever number you achieve this year, let's say 180 crore, 200 crore, whatever that number will be, should we then just grow it in line with the number of store additions, or is there something more that we have to do?
So, on delivery, yes, the growth rates have been very good over the last 2 years. And like we have always mentioned, our core is dine-in, and we are working on building another vehicle for ourselves, which is delivery, which we see as a strong potential segment and category, and we aspire to become one of the prominent players in the Indian cuisine delivery segment, right? And that's what we are working for. I think the market there is huge, and even though we are looking like tracking almost 200 crores per annum segment, I think the market is much, much larger, right? What we are only saying is that our focus on dine-in will continue as we have done in the past. And it's easy to give you a prediction on that. On delivery, this business is very young. Our focus on that has been 4 to 6 quarters old. And every passing quarter and months, we are improving on our delivery business, and we are exploring new things there. So I would not give any guidance on that right now, but given the market potential and given that the focus and the bandwidth that we're spending on this segment, we should, the delivery segment should grow more than our dining segment.
Right, understood. Secondly, any concerns you have on the inflationary environment, and do you have the pricing power to sort of offset that and get to that 15% kind of EBITDA margin that we talked about despite the inflation?
So, one is yes, there are concerns on inflation. It is across the board, and we also have that. We have some taken some tactical measures to ensure that we don't lose on our gross margins. But this is something which is hitting us on a daily basis currently, and we are working towards that. While we have this amount of pricing power, you know that historically over the last 5 years, our average price increase has not been more than 3-4%, and we don't want to go beyond that. I think this brand has to remain value for money for our guests, and that's what we are very focused on. In terms of 15% EBITDA margin, I think the business is already at around 21% store level margin, and you see that in the full ops in also in quarter two. And our corporate expenditure will anyway on a larger base of revenue as a percentage coming down. So blended 15, I think, should be should not be a challenge.
Okay, sir, that's all from me. Thanks, Madhus.
Thank you, Pasu.
Thank you very much. That was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Thank you, everyone, for your participation, and we wish you a very happy weekend. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and wish you all a very happy Diwali too. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Participant on behalf of Embit Capital, that concludes this conference call. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.